That's brand new from Olivia Newton-John, the title song from a brand new album to be released tomorrow, Come On Over, and that was written by the two of the guys of the Bee Gees. My guest here sitting next to me is Leonard Rosenman. Leonard, welcome to Spotlight on a Star.
Thank you, David.
And let's see, most people are probably not familiar with you too much. I understand that one of your most famous things right now is that the soundtrack to Barry Lyndon.
Yes, it's odd because it's really not mine, although I put it together. It consists of music of Vivaldi, Schubert, Mozart, Bach, and Handel, and some other stuff. But I do write original music, too.
How did you get involved with film music?
Well, it was quite odd. I taught at Berkeley for a while, and finally went to Tanglewood, the Berkshire Music Center, and this assumed the position of composer in residence there, and then moved to New York. And while I lived in New York, I taught piano. One of my students was James Dean, and since I was at that time I had not contemplated entering films, but was a concert composer. I had a lot of performances in New York, and Jimmy took Kazan, the director, to see one of my concerts, and he asked if I'd like to score what was Jimmy's first film and my first film, which was East of Eden. That's how I got into it.
How many times do you see a movie before you start composing the score?
Well, as many times as I wish to, or as many times as I can stand it, or something like that, you know.
Okay, the first score we're going to hear a selection from is A Man Called Horse. How many times did you see this movie before you started scoring?
Well, this was a really close collaboration because, with regard to Horse, I went on location. I had very, very close contact with the Sioux Indians. The Rosebud Reservation, and collected a great deal of really important material, which found its way into the score. So I saw the film. Actually, I saw it being shot many, during the location shooting, and then of course I saw rushes, and I saw it many, many times.
Now the selection we're going to hear is called the Finale. Would you tell us some of the interesting things about this selection?
Well, I don't know if they're interesting, but there's some. They're interesting to me anyway. I tried a kind of a virtuoso stunt in the finale. What I tried to do, essentially, was to take almost all the original Indian material that I collected in the film and put them all together with a giant chorus and an orchestra and play them all in counterpoint so that it's a kind of a, I guess it would be called kind of an Indian contrapuntal mass of some kind. But all the material there, even though I've arranged it and put it all together, and they work together, oddly enough. The orchestral material, the accompaniment, of course, is mine, but it's all based on original Indian material. And that's the kind of climax of the film.
Was the finale from A Man Called Horse. We're here on Spotlight on a Star. My name is Dave Schwartz. My guest in the first hour of tonight's show is Leonard Rosenman. And we've got some more questions. How often does the producer or the director give you suggestions as to what type of music they want in the movie?
Quite often. Great deal of the time, it's really wrong. Many filmmakers, I'd say most filmmakers, really don't understand the relationship between music and cinema. They don't understand what music can do and what it can't do, what its dramatic function is. Usually, those of us who are diplomatic, and I've been at times diplomatic and at times undiplomatic, the diplomatic approach is to say, yes, you're right, and do it your own way. Because what most people fail to realize is that aside from composers, people who write music for films and functional media are also dramatists, and that they see music in a certain dramatic or dramaturgic role. There are exceptions. I work, for example, with Bob Radnitz, who made Sounder, and he's done another film which is going to be released in April, a remarkable little film, and I felt that we had an incredible communication. He knew exactly what he wanted, and I knew what I wanted, and sometimes he won, sometimes I won, but we had a real communication, and that was very fruitful.
Now, the next score we've got coming up is one of the Planet of the Apes scores. Now, I want you to tell us the selection we're going to play, I believe, is the March of the Apes?
Yes, it was a kind of satiric march that I did. The march that is on the soundtrack is slightly different than the march in the film, in that I tried a kind of an inside joke in the soundtrack, which I didn't do in the film, and that is to make a kind of rock type march of the thing, and make the ape march into a kind of rock thing. It's a very wild piece, I must say. And it's absolute, it's decibel, I mean, it's shattering. So there it is, for what it's worth.
From the Planet of the Apes. And it's 15 minutes past 8 o'clock here on KCSN Radio. This is Spotlight on a Star. Tonight, our special guest is Leonard Rosenman. Getting back to Planet of the Apes, how hard was it composing the score for that movie?
How hard?
Yeah.
Oh, it was cinch. It was marvelous. First of all, I was working with a marvelous man. Arthur Jacobs is dead now, the producer of all the Apes films. And we were very, very close friends, and it was just absolute carte blanche to do anything I wanted. It was an awful lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
One gets spoiled by these few and far between kinds of situations.
What type of orchestra did you use to record that soundtrack?
No violins. Great deal of brass, winds, percussion, low strings, as cello and basses. Harpsichord, amplified harpsichord. Let's see now. Guitar with ring modulators and all kinds of electronic equipment. That was the...
Now, the next selection we have up coming is another selection from Planet of the Apes. I believe it's the title track. How about this selection?
The main title? Well, it was a kind of a neutral thing because, first of all, it was basically a recap. The main title was kind of a flashback to the first Apes. And although I didn't want to do Apes 1 all over again, because Jerry Goldsmith had done that, Jerry and I, parenthetically, were friends of Arthur's, and Arthur decided that arbitrarily Jerry would do odd-numbered Apes and I'd do the even-numbered Apes. And so I wanted to write something that really created a whole different mood, a much more avant-garde mood, I felt, than Apes 1. And I think I've achieved it in that main title.
Okay, that was the title theme from the Planet of the Apes, the second Apes film. Now, I believe that there were four films in the series?
Five.
And you did the scores for the second and the fourth?
The fourth was tracked from both the first and the second. I did the second and fifth.
Mm-hmm. How come there was no soundtrack ever released on the fifth?
Oh, I don't know. I think it was probably a throwaway by that time.
I noticed we've compiled a list here of all the scores that you've done, and very few have ever been available on soundtrack.
Yeah, my biographers, so to speak, are always concerned with what they call my unaccountably low profile, and that's simply because I never went out to do. See, I have unfortunately a rather schizophrenic type of existence, in that I pursue two careers simultaneously, unlike most of my colleagues, and that is that I'm a composer, conductor, pianist on the concert field also. And so I just, films are a way of making a living, although I like doing them, and I think I do them well. But I don't play that kind of game generally. So I haven't gone off of the soundtrack albums, and only lately has there been interest in my work.
Now, you mentioned your classical field. How about telling us a little bit more about this?
Well, it's I conduct concerts. As a matter of fact, last night I conducted the Valley Symphony, and we got the best players, and we did last night, the night before, an all Bach program. And then March 11th, I'm playing and conducting at Ambassador College in an all Bach program. And then I'm conducting at the Kennedy Center in Washington, June, some of my own work, some work of my contemporaries, and then conducting at the International Festival in Boston in October, another chamber work of mine, a large work, which I'm recording for Delos, May. So that, you know, I'm kind of busy. Then next year sees four world premieres of mine, one in London, November 19th, and one here with Neville Mariner conducting the L.A. Chamber Orchestra, the commissioned work, concerto for bass fiddle and four-string quartets, and Chamber Music 3 and Chamber Music 4, and then a symphonic work back east.
Have any of the other any of your other classical works been recorded on record?
Yeah, there is a piece for violin, a duo for violin and piano has been recorded on Orion. Bob Gross did an excellent performance.
Mm-hmm. Now let's get back into some more music from A Man Called Horse.
Thank you.
another selection from the motion picture soundtrack of A Man Called Horse. And that album was released by Columbia Records. It is another, it's discontinued now, so it's become a collector's item. This is Spotlight on a Star. My name is Dave Schwartz. We'll be talking with Leonard Rosenman in a couple minutes. A reminder, coming up in the second hour on tonight's program, we have an interview with Haygood Hardy. He is the man who had the big top 40 hit of The Homecoming and has his first album out on Capitol. We'll be talking with him about his career. We're also going to find out something very interesting about the Canadian Talent Library. That'll be coming up in the 9 to 10 hour of Spotlight on a Star tonight. And following us tonight at 10 o'clock, we have the pure nonsense of Paul Madrid and Dimension 88. Right now, before we get back to Leonard, let's hear a little bit of some of his one of his James Dean scores. This is the main theme from East of Eden.
That was not as previously reported, East of Eden. That was the main title to Rebel Without a Cause. Do I get Union Scale as an announcer on this?
No, this is non-commercial.
Okay. Non-commercial Union Scale. Anyway, that's the main title to the third film I had scored, which was Rebel Without a Cause, the film which is credited with starting juvenile delinquency in the middle class. So I can take that dubious honor in having participated in that. It was a very extraordinary experience, that film, because it was basically a B-movie with a very extraordinary actor in it. Of course, it was James Dean. And nobody for a second thought it was going to become a classic. Nobody. It was, as a matter of fact, it was on television just a few nights ago again. I mean, it's on, when I went to England to do Barry Lyndon, there it was, all over the BBC. And people just absolutely going crackers over it, which is something I simply still don't understand to this day.
Now we have another selection coming up from the same movie. I believe it's the one you chose, and I pointed out to my engineer, and I forgot the title.
It's the end title in Plato's Death, and I'm very fond of doing this in a lot of movies, of bringing in all the elements together in counterpoint at the end of the film, as I do in this. I bring all the themes together in the film, in this kind of death and resurrection kind of cue.
Title from Rebel Without a Cause, that movie from 1955. Let's see, noticing here I've compiled sort of a Leonard Rosenman film discography of all the films you've composed, and there's one album we don't have, The Edge of the City and the Cobweb, which was an album released by MGM, but we unfortunately do not have a copy. And while we can't play the music, we should make some comments about the score.
Yes, the record itself, you know, is a collector's item now, and selling for $75 a piece and up. It was a kind of a kind of milestone in film music. I'm talking about Cobweb, which was my second film. I did it actually, yes, in 55. It was a milestone because what it served to do historically in films was to bring film music into the 20th century, because it was the first avant-garde, it was the first serial score ever written for a motion picture in a large studio. And most of us expected that the film score would be thrown out. But indeed, they liked. Of course, I happened to work for a producer who had tremendous stature, and who to this day is an extraordinary man. That's John Houseman, who suddenly and very late in life became an actor. And was coming from films, he went to become the dean of the theater in Juilliard School of Music. So it wasn't as if I was working with some kind of a, you know, an ex-agent type. This was a very important and interesting urbane man who understood the import of what I was doing and gave me carte blanche to do it. And why MGM recorded this, I don't know, but they may have had some kind of historical perspective on it. And when it came out, it didn't sell many albums except to people. Most of the fan letters I got on that were from college professors and conductors and people of that kind who thought, and they all said the same thing, how'd you get away with it? Because at that time, you have to realize, Max Steiner was still alive, Dmitri Tiomkin was going very strong, Franz Waxman was writing, Miklos Rocha was in the fore. And they were both mostly music of a 19th century nature in films. And this really basically, that and Eden both were film scores also, instead of dealing with this enormous bloated orchestra, which had become very fashionable, dealt with large orchestras, but using small combinations within the orchestra so that there were kind of extended kinds of chamber music, and utilizing real mid-20th century techniques at that time. So I'm sorry we don't have that record, because it might be of some interest to your listeners.
How has film music changed since 1955? How is it compared today?
Well, there are actually two people that changed the face of film music totally. And they were Alex North and myself. And both Alex and myself came in under the aegis of Elia Kazan. Alex came in doing Streetcar Named Desire, and I came in doing East of Eden for that same director. And it's changed grossly. I'm not in a position to say that if not for Alex and myself, there wouldn't be so-and-so. But we certainly did open the way for the new group of really well-trained and expressive composers who understand 20th century techniques, like Jerry Goldsmith and Lalo Schifrin and Johnny Williams and people like that. And it's really too bad that that of all the people, the only one that seems to write a bit is Jerry Goldsmith. And Johnny writes a bit too, but I mean that don't really pursue a full-time concert career on the side, because some of them are really, really gifted, especially Jerry. He's a fantastic composer.
Okay, the next selection we have up is another one from Rebel Without a Cause called End of the World. And
this is a typical example. You see, the entire inspiration for film music up to that time were works of Richard Strauss, Wagner, Rachmaninoff, Tchaikovsky. Well, this piece, this is a planetarium sequence in Rebel Without a Cause, was at that time influenced by a piece which was avant-garde at that time, and which was very new at that time, which was the music of strings, percussion, celesta by Bartok, which had just come out. And it wasn't just composed, but it just became public and known to us.
Thank you. Okay, that was still another selection from Rebel Without a Cause. And we're going to get into East of Eden, the other James Dean score that Leonard composed, in just a couple minutes. I also understand you have a very famous TV theme. Marcus Welby.
Oh, Marcus Welby, yes, yes. As a matter of fact, I had three famous TV themes. My track record in television was actually rather good. First, I did The Defenders, which became the kind of trumpet player's great dream, because they always played that first fanfare. I used to hear that in rehearsals of symphony orchestras all the time. And that ran, of course, the series ran a long time. Then I did Combat, which was a big theme. And as a matter of fact, there was a move on for a while. The infantry wanted to adopt that as its marching song. And I think, I don't know what happened, but it didn't happen. But it was another one of these themes that lasted, you know. Now, of course, Marcus Welby has gone on for 7 years.
How about some of the themes that on shows that didn't last?
Oh, yes. I lived in Italy from 62 to 66 in Rome. And when I came to Italy in 62 sometime after that, I turned on the television set to see what Italian television was like. And the first thing I saw, I heard a sound of music that sounded very familiar to me. And I saw the title, and at that time my Italian was starting to get good. And it said, Lo Sceriffo in Indiano, which means the sheriff is an Indian. I said, what the heck is... Oh, my God, it was a Plainsman. It was a show I did years and years ago. Do you have that at all?
No, we don't have any of your TV themes.
Well, it's a series I did that lasted a year. It had the most absurd plot you can imagine. The plot took place around 1880s or something like that. And it was kind of a slice of life, you know. It had to do with an Indian who had gone to Harvard and had come back as a U.S. Marshal. I mean, can you imagine that? And, of course, seeing this now dubbed in Italian was even funnier. That's one of the things that I wrote. Then I did a huge million-dollar pilot, which never sold, called Alexander the Great. And I scored it with a gigantic men's chorus, and the large orchestra sounded like Alexander Nevsky. It was a huge thing, but it didn't go. And so on. All of the guys who work in this field have those kinds of things in the closet, you know.
Have you ever thought of compiling an album of some of your more famous TV themes?
Yeah, yes, I certainly have. I haven't done too much about it. And this is, of course, the problem of my profile, because I just... those things take time. And within the priorities of my life, I would rather take the time to write a new piece of music, you know, a concert piece or even a new film, rather than take the time to do that kind of thing.
And one of the labels that you mentioned, I think it's Delos, or Delos.
Delos, yes.
Started a new film series.
Indeed they have, yes. They're very enterprising, and I think they're going to do very well.
Are you planning to do any special film albums for them?
We spoke about it. As a matter of fact, I will say it, why not? I might be offering them a film that I just did for Bob Radnitz, which is an extraordinary film, has a good theme to it, as a soundtrack album, and I think they'd probably be happy to get it. So I think that they're a very enterprising company, and I think the soundtracks have really caught on now. I think the latest rage, people are buying them all over the place. Certainly Barry Lyndon is doing very well. And aside from that, I mean, I happen to think that Barry Lyndon is an extraordinary soundtrack album, thanks to Larry Marks and Warner Brothers, who helped put the thing together. It's one of the most beautiful soundtrack albums I've ever heard from the standpoint of recording, since we recorded with the London combination of the London Symphony and the London Philharmonic in an old church outside of London. And we didn't use movie engineers, we used the deck engineers. They were sensational.
Okay, we're going to get to Barry Lyndon in a couple minutes. Right now, let's get to East of Eden.
Mm-hmm.
The first selection we've got is the Nocturne.
Yeah, this is where Jimmy goes up to Julie Harris's bedroom at night, and he's drunk and invites her to the birthday party the next day. And it's one of these kinds of gossamer, almost Ravello, Debussy-like things, which have a lot of the themes in counterpoint.
Thank you.
nocturne from East. That was. That was the nocturne from East of Eden. That was 1955. The soundtrack album notes was originally released on Warner Brothers, and we've got it on an Imperial sort of album that was put together on the three James Dean scores.
Right.
And I believe it was just reissued a couple years ago by Warner Brothers.
No, it was reissued a couple of months ago.
A couple months ago.
Yes. Reissued with some dialogue, I understand. I haven't heard the album, but I hear that they did reissue it.
I have to keep a watch out for it.
Yeah, there's a kind of James Dean craze going on.
And I believe also there's a new James Dean film that they're going to do on the night that he died, September 30th, 55.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Universal, I believe, is the one who's going to do it, and it'll be out, they're going to start shooting it later this year.
Uh-huh. Well, there it is.
They may call you up and have you do a score for it.
Oh, boy, it would be like working in an embalming organization.
Anyway, we've got another theme coming up from East of Eden. This, I believe, is the main title, so...
Right.
Introduce it.
Well, it's... nothing to say about it, except that when I had an interview with Kazan prior to doing the film, he said, can you write a... He said, I know your avant-garde music, and I like that kind of music for the film, but can you write a kind of a simple tune? And I said, well, that should be quite simple for a real composer. And he said, can I hear it? I said, well, I'll tell you what, give me about 10 minutes and I'll write it. So it took me about 7.5 minutes by the clock, which is a kind of a dare. And I wrote that tune, which turned out to be a kind of a lovely tune. And of course, everyone since then had thought it was a folk tune or something, but it's not, it's an original tune.
This is Spotlight on the Star on KCSN Northridge. I'm your host, Dave Schwartz. My guest is Leonard Rosenman, noted film composer, TV composer, and classical composer. A triple threat here. Okay, we're going to go into Barry Lyndon in a couple minutes, but before we do that, we're going to take a look at some of the other films that you've composed the music for.
Mm-hmm.
I believe we left off with The Edge of the City, so we had one called The Young Stranger.
Oh, yeah, that was John Frankenheimer's first film that he directed. I have nothing to say about it.
Okay, and let's see, it was Lafayette
Escadrille.
Yeah, I couldn't pronounce it if I tried.
No, it was, as far as I'm concerned, the worst picture ever made, but I understand that the director, Wild Bill Wellman, just adored it. So, you know, it takes all kinds to make horse races, and there you have it. I wrote a nice tune for it, though. It's too bad it went into that film. Next.
Next one was Pork Chop Hill in 1959.
Yeah, that was Gregory Peck's own company. It was a good film and an interesting score, I thought.
In 1960, The Bramble Bush.
Oh, yeah, it was a bunch of potboilers for Warner Brothers. Actually, why don't we go on and go on to the interesting films, like, for example, The Outsider.
Okay, that's 1961.
Which I did with Delbert Mann. And Delbert and I still lecture on that film every year at Claremont College. I also worked with Delbert. That was with Tony Curtis. It was about that Iwo Jima veteran, the Indian who raised the flag on Iwo Jima, who died drunk, you know. And it was maybe Tony Curtis's best performance ever in films. And it was a beautifully directed film, and from the standpoint of the music, the music served. We made really interesting montages. It was a fascinating assignment working with a marvelous man.
Now, one that was released on soundtrack was the Chapman Report.
Oh yeah, well, I don't know why they released it on the soundtrack. Oh yes, I remember, because I went to Italy, and we recorded there. And the Italian orchestras are marvelous, but they really had no idea of how to play this kind of music. So I felt a fiasco.
Okay, let's skip on now to Fantastic Voyage.
Yeah, Fantastic Voyage, the Chapman Report was 62, Fantastic Voyage was 66. Those were the perimeter, that's the perimeter of my stay in Italy, 62 to 66. Now, I ran into Dick Fleischer, who directed the Fantastic Voyage in Italy. We became very close friends, and we still are. And the Fantastic Voyage was a much more radical score than any of the other things that I had done, or for that matter, anyone else had ever done. It consisted of two different orchestras playing different rhythms and everything else. It was really, absolutely way out.
Now, in 1968, you did one called Countdown.
Yeah, that was a science fiction film. It was Robert Altman's first film. And due to the vicissitudes of this weird business, the film was never released. And it was released at TWA, and Charles Champlin, from the movie critic of the LA Times, happened to be going cross-country in a plane, saw it, and wrote a whole column on this neglected masterpiece. Mm. A marvelous film.
Well, maybe one of these days somebody will get it out and show it.
Well, I've seen it on television. It's been truncated terribly where it doesn't make any sense anymore, but it's a beautiful film, exquisite film, about the first landing on the moon.
Now, there's also a couple films that I do not have on my list here in the past two or three years.
Yes, well, that's After a Man Called Horse. You have the ape films there, do you?
We have it was 1970, Beneath the Planet.
Beneath, and then there was another one, the last one, what was called Conquest of the Planet of the Apes, I think. And then there's Birch Interval, which is not released yet. Man Called Horse, Race with the Devil, kind of an exploitation picture at Fox, but with an interesting score. With Peter Fonda and Warren Oates, and a film that I'm recording this week called The Last Hard Man with Charlton Heston and Jimmy Coburn, a big 20th Century Fox Western.
Do you foresee a soundtrack on that album?
I don't think so. No, I can't imagine. It's not that kind of film. No, it's not a big country type film. It's a real action kind of film, and most of the music is action music.
Okay, now we're going to get into Barry Lyndon. This is the score that's nominated for the Academy Award for Best Adapted Score, I believe.
Right, yes.
And judging by your competition, I hope you win.
I do, too.
I think it's Tommy and Funny Lady of the competition
this
year.
That's correct, yes.
And I've listened to all three albums, and this album, by far, hands down, should be the winner.
Oh, well, if you're dealing with albums, of course you're dealing with films, too. And I haven't, frankly, seen Tommy or Funny Lady. But I can't tell whether the films are competitive. But after all, it's not the Grammys; it's the Oscars, which have to do not so much with the soundtrack. As I said before, I consider this soundtrack to be particularly beautiful. But it's the way music is used in the film, and so on. So I can't really tell what the competition is going to be like yet.
Now, you used various pieces by various classical composers. How did you decide exactly what piece you were going to use for what thing?
Well, Stanley Kubrick amassed a great library of classical music in preparation for this film. And he had made certain choices, some of the choices which we kept, some of the choices which we kept and used in different places where he originally wanted them. And some of the pieces came from his library, but were not originally chosen. So we kind of chose them together, you know. And put the music in the film. I must say that the main theme of the picture, the Saraband, was not originally envisioned by Stanley as the main theme of the film. And we had a kind of test session where I made an arrangement of it, and he liked it so much that we did use it as the main idea of the film, as the Handel Saraband.
Okay, the first selection we're going to hear is a Franz Schubert selection, German Dance Number 1 in C Major.
Right, yes. I'm particularly proud of this performance, by the way.
That was a selection by Frederick the Great, or it was composed by Frederick the Great. You're my pronunciation man here. Pronounce it for me.
Oh, Der Hohen Friedberger. It's a German war march, which Frederick II wrote in the 18th century, and I made an arrangement of it for kind of 18th century band, small band, and we recorded it in this marvelous church.
Now, what size orchestra did you use for the soundtrack of Barry Lyndon?
Oh, the pieces varied, of course. At one point, I think you're going to play the Saraband duel. At one point, and that's
that'll be next up.
Yes, scored for 12 timpani, three players, so they can play the whole tune on it, and three double basses and six celli. That's the whole shtick, you know. Then, of course, the main title, which you'll play later on. The Saraband is recorded with a large string section, about 50 strings, timpani and harpsichord continuo. And then this Hohen Friedberger, which you just heard, is recorded with about 18 men, which is a kind of a size of a German military band of that time.
Now, as we're not going to have time to listen to the entire soundtrack, would you like to make some comments about some of the other selections on it?
Yes. It's a tremendously varietous soundtrack, because you've got, as is the soundtrack of the film, of course, and it thus represents a selection from the film. You've got really classical music. There's some marvelous music from Mozart and Vivaldi, as well as Handel and Schubert. And you've also got some fabulous Irish folk music done by a group called the Chieftains, which, by the way, have been just wowing them all over the continent and now in the United States on a world tour. And they play the original instruments, and we recorded them in Dublin. We went to Dublin and recorded them. And they're a remarkable group, and the music almost sounds as though it was written yesterday, but it really wasn't. It really sounds very strange and interesting.
What were some of the instruments? You said original instruments.
Oh, yes, the Bauron, for example, which is a marvelous kind of drum, which is struck with the knuckles, and bones, and then tin whistles, and all kinds of fantastic, lovely Irish instruments.
Okay, let's get into the selection we have now. This is the one by Handel. The Sarabandoule.
Yes, that's the one where I use 12 timpani and 6 celli and 4 double basses. That's 2 seconds.
Okay, and the crack there is due to the fact that most of the English pressings of the album, which is what we're using tonight, are not up to the great standards of the American records at this time. Normally it's the other way around. But if you listen to the American version of the American pressing of the record, there's no problem with it. But be careful about the English pressings. Okay, what's up next? What's in your immediate future that you'd like to tell the audience before we have to say goodbye to you?
Well, the immediate future is a series of, as I said before, world premieres of new works. And some films which are in the talking stage that I can't talk about yet. And That's about it. And hopefully the Oscar.
Well, best of luck in the Oscar. Keep us informed as to what you're up to. And we're going to close now with the main title from Barry Lyndon. Main title from Barry Lyndon, and a very special thanks to Leonard Rosenman for taking time out to stop by and talk with us tonight. And we'd also like to thank Mr. Jim Parker, who loaned us most of the soundtracks that you heard in the last hour and 15 minutes. And a special thanks to Norman Gimbel, whose idea was to have Leonard out here in the first place. And to even honor Norman, who's got a song nominated for the Academy Award this year. And before we get into our interview with Haygood Hardy, here is the song Richard's Window from The Other Side of the Mountain. This version is a brand new single sung by Leslie Kendall.
I try to see all that he saw.